Wow, thank you. It's wonderful to be back in Bath, and from that, welcome. I think maybe this really is an audience of patriotic pro-Europeans. When I was last in Bath, it was for this Channel 4 event, which was supposedly for people who were pro-Europeans, but about half the audience wasn't pro-European at all. There were some infiltrators. Maybe it was Rees-Mogg had sent his fifth colonist to the event. Anyway, I want to ask a question. Times do move on, and although I do agree with what I said then, I am more optimistic about our ability to stop Brexit than I was then.
Yes!
And even in the dire days of about a year ago, when it really, really did look terrible for our cause, I clung on to a few shreds of hope. But of course then, Theresa May made a wonderful unforced error. And she called an election. And we've actually had two wonderful unforced errors this year. The first was Nigel Farage, who decided that he was warming to the idea of another referendum. Bring it on, Nigel! And then, Jacob Rees-Mogg. Jacob Rees-Mogg, what actually was worrying me towards the end of last year is what I call the Gove Plan. In the first year or so of, post-referendum, the Brexiters' mantra, which of course Theresa May copied, was no deal is better than a bad deal. Then she lost her majority, she lost her mojo, and of course she doesn't have a majority to push through no deal. Now, I'm not complacent, there still is a risk that we have no deal just out of cock-up rather than conspiracy. But what the, under the Gove Plan, Michael Gove, he suddenly, there's a light bulb, went off in his brain, I think, around September, October, of last year, and he suddenly thought, oh my God, no deal might mean no Brexit,
yes.
Because that will frighten the horses. And so suddenly you saw it was like sort of a turning on a sixpence. The mantra changed from no deal is better than a bad deal, that any deal is better than no deal. and that was basically where, of course I'm not inside their camp, but I imagine they have one of these WhatsApp groups. And Michael Gove saying, don't disrupt what Theresa May is doing. We're going to pay $39 billion. It's fantastic. It's all for the better, for the future. Just keep your mouth zipped. And that actually is what basically happened. Even Boris Johnson, who said, go whistle, in the summer of last year, by the time, go whistle, which was, we're not going to pay you any money, by the time it was £39 billion, which is quite a lot of money, he said, oh, I think this is a bloody good deal. how was that possible? Well, again, I'm not inside their camp, but my suspicion is that Michael Gove, it was the Gove Plan, he said, come on, Boris, just, you've got to see the bigger picture. What we've got to do is we've got to get the hell out of the EU before the people realise how ghastly it's going to be. So zip your mouth, don't disturb, don't derail Theresa May. She's got to deliver, it's going to be terrible, but we are the true believers and we will eventually reach this promised land. But we'll only do that if you zip your mouth. And the Gove Plan actually worked all the way from, let's say, around late October until Christmas. But then we got Jacob Rees-Mogg. And Jacob Rees-Mogg, who I believe is somewhat local, somebody said that Bath is the, he doesn't have Bath, because Bath is fantastically pro-European, patriotic pro-European city. Let us not forget, let us not allow them to suggest that they are the patriots. We are the patriots, because what we are doing is we are fighting for Britain's prosperity and Britain's power, and they're the ones who are selling us down the river. Mm. Anyway, somebody said to me that Bath is the jam in his donut. Well, certainly. I want to confess something. There's one thing that I will confess it. There is one thing that I share in common with Jacob Rees-Mogg, is that I loved my nanny. when I was a child and I had a donut, it was always the jam that I liked most. Anyway, but he has, in my view, made an even bigger unforced error. First unforced error, not perhaps as big as Theresa May's unforced error of last summer calling the election, but bigger even, but bigger than the Farage error. And his error is that he has deviated from the Gove plan. He was supposed to keep his mouth bloody zipped. But the problem with Jacob Rees-Mogg is that he is a, what we know in journalism as a media harlot. He can't get up in the morning without wondering, where are the TV cameras? And to get the TV cameras to come, what he has to do is he has to give them some red meat. And that means he can't keep his mouth zipped. And so what he did is he started attacking Theresa May's transition, saying it's a vassal state. I think, fantastic. Attack it. Let's attack what the government is doing from our side of the spectrum, and let's attack it from his side of the spectrum. It is what she is doing. If, frankly, she knew what she was doing, which, well, she doesn't know what she's doing, is bad for everybody. So, that was... wasn't actually planning to say any of that. The main message I wanted to give you... Actually, that's a question, actually. Put up your hands if you think that we can stop Brexit. Okay? And put up your hands if you think we can't stop Brexit. Okay, and put up your hands if you didn't put up your hands in one of those two cases. Because logically, you should have been in one other than the other, but perhaps my... So basically, I think we had slightly over half said we can, probably about a third said we were in the middle, or a quarter we said in the middle, and probably little, about 20% or so said we can't. I mean, what I think that means is that the people who were not in the middle, but who were in neither one nor the other, they probably think that we won't, but that it's not a lost cause. Is that right, Catherine?
Yeah, okay.
I mean, I see one person who I know who's in that category, and I'm, of course, generalising from a sample of one, which is much more scientific than the process. Well, I must say, I am probably in that middle category, but I would actually express it as, yes, we can. As Barack Obama said, yes, we can. But that doesn't mean to say that we will. We only will if we put in the effort, if we fight for it, if we go for it. Of course, events may come in our direction, but we need to actually believe, and enough of us need to believe, and then we get a critical mass, and it will happen. And, okay, so how can we? Predicting what's going to happen in politics is a mug's game, but let me be a mug. So, the decisive battle will happen around the end of this year, if Theresa May does a deal, if she still is Prime Minister, let's assume again, I'm predicting, she comes back with a deal, and it will be a crap deal. The good thing that happened before Christmas was that there were enough Tory mutineers who were prepared to put their heads above the parapet and face the machine gun fire, go through not just the three-line whip of the Tory party, something much, much more fearsome than the three-line whip of the Tory party, the four-line whip of the Daily Mail and the Daily Telegraph. And there were 11 of them, led by Dominic Grieve, who were brave enough, and Anna Subri and Nicky Morgan, etc., etc., who actually had the guts to do it. And the good thing is, she doesn't have a majority, and 11 were enough. But what wasn't just that they showed that they were willing to fight, they actually secured, in legislation, the promise of future legislation when this deal comes back, if there is a deal. Now, the good thing, that's the crunch moment. That is our target. What we need to do is we need to persuade Parliament at that moment in time that this is a crap deal and that it cannot go through unless the British people consent to it. So I know there are some people who think, well, we should just expect Parliament to say no. That is not realistic, and I'm not even sure it's democratic. I don't believe all of this will of the people guff. However, we did have a referendum, and it's like driving into a cul-de-sac. When you drive into a dead end, you somehow, sometimes, I mean, unless you're sort of Batman with your Batmobile and you can fly up, you have to go back the way that you went in. So the target is stop this bad deal and say, look, you know, this looks like a terrible deal. This isn't what the British people were promised 2 years ago. This isn't what was on the battle bus. This isn't £350 million for the NHS. Actually, it's going to damage the NHS. And this whole idea of global Britain, that we're going to have deals with China and India and America that are going to replace and more than compensate for the loss of our trade with Europe, it's complete nonsense. And in fact, what we're staring at is a low growth, low investment, low pay economy for as far as the eye can see. What we're looking at is not taking back control, but losing control and losing power for Britain. That's why we are the Patriots, yes. Because we are fighting for the power of Britain. But anyway, the British people in their wisdom did say they wanted a Brexit, and you know, this is what's come back, and it's really, you know, a dog's dinner. We better just check that they really want it. So that's the target. That's the realistic target. I know there's some people who've got some other targets, but in my view, that's the only realistic target. But to get to that, we need a majority in the House of Commons. And so what we need to do is we need to persuade MPs. And unfortunately, there aren't very many MPs at the moment who are prepared to stick their heads above the parapet. But we did have that important vote before Christmas, showing that not on quite this issue, but that there is the makings of a coalition. Okay, put simply, we need the whole of the Labour Party, the SNP, Lib Dems, Greens. Okay, we shouldn't take them for granted, but they're in the bag. And 10, probably 20 to be safe, Tory MPs. That is the goal. Now, what has to happen is that they need to feel that the people are behind them. If they feel the people are not behind them, there won't be enough politicians who are willing to take the plunge. So that's why what all of you are doing here and around the country in the grassroots, and I think what Bath for Europe is doing is fantastic. I know you're part of affiliated to Britain for Europe. I like your, you know, Tom Brufato, I know a lot of people. I've been speaking around the country. I know a lot of your grassroots colleagues. So I think it's wonderful what you're doing, and what you're doing is really important. And in that vote just before Christmas, probably wasn't relevant here in Bath because you've got Vera Hobhouse, who is a fantastic pro-European, but actually the grassroots campaign was probably absolutely critical in flipping enough Tory MPs over the line, because it was only by a few votes. You know, if we'd got, I think it was like two fewer MPs, we wouldn't have won that. And that was because of really good grassroots campaign. You contributed. You should be proud of what you did. Well, if we had been here a year ago, you, Alan, might have said the same thing. Because after the referendum, we only lost by 4%, 48-52. But we immediately lost almost all of our MPs. We lost all of our newspapers. Hardly anybody wanted to pay any attention to us. The Labour Party was, the so-called opposition, was completely useless. Activists, apart from a few brave souls like people in this room, they lost faith. And frankly, you know, for organisations like mine, we found it almost impossible to raise money. So we had to operate on a shoestring. Then we had that wonderful election, and we have been in a virtuous cycle. It's not going fast enough, but it is virtuous. So what's happened is that MPs are creeping back. The Labour Party is finally acting as a sort of opposition, a proper opposition. It doesn't have the right policy on Brexit, but it is creeping in the right direction. Public opinion is starting to change. You probably all saw that opinion poll in The Guardian last week, which showed particularly, in fact, this idea that there should be a final say. The people should have the final say on the deal. 58% to 42%. That was the first time there was a really decisive majority in favour of giving people the final say. Unfortunately, it was only a narrow majority in our favour if they actually got the final say, but, you know, we're making progress. And if you start having politicians who start saying, well, actually, you know, it's not over yet, if you have newspapers starting to entertain the possibility that actually there might be another referendum and that Brexit might not happen, if you have foreign leaders like Emmanuel Macron and Donald Tusk, a couple of weeks ago, Macron, when he was here, he said, I would love Britain to stay in the UK. And Donald Tusk, who's the president of the European Council, he said, our heart is open. I mean, they were love bombing us. And those people who say that we can't change our mind because it's too late, they are not speaking the truth. Because not only do we have the right under Article 50 to change our mind until that last minute in the 29th of March next year, but even if you can say quibble about that, the fact is they want us. So if we do change our mind, we can. Now, of course, we still have to change our mind. Not people in this room, but people outside this room have to change their mind. And then the other thing that's changed and I don't know, actually, where is Claire, our wonderful chair? Claire the chair. There is Claire. Has your supporters, has that grown in the last year?
Yes, but every week or so, people.
It's great. Okay, so there's, and it's wonderful. We've got a full house here. You've all paid money to see a middle-aged man in the evening, in the middle of winter. I mean, hats off to you. That is showing something. And the other thing is to just, I can tell you, I mean, we are having, as I said, not being able to raise money, or barely able to raise money. In the last couple of months, we've raised over £200,000 for Impacts. And if you don't know Impacts, infacts.org, you can get a daily newsletter from us. That's the end of my commercial. So things are moving. We've gone from this negative feedback loop into a positive feedback loop. But I don't want to exaggerate it. The speed is not fast enough. We have to accelerate it. There is good news, you know. I mean, the chaos within the government, partly triggered by your local hero, Jacob Rees-Mogg, is making that. And I must say, there was one thing, the best thing today, I think, was who knows who Nick Timothy is.
Yes.
He was Theresa May's chief of staff. He got fired because he had this brilliant idea of calling an election. Anyway, but he writes a weekly, I think, column in the Daily Telegraph. And he said something, actually, one of the first times that I completely agree with him. He said that if Theresa May goes, that may mean the end of Brexit. Now, why? Because there will be complete civil war within the Conservative Party. There is nobody that they can rally behind. They will tear each other's eyes out. They will tear each other's livers out and eat it raw. And it will not be a pretty spectacle. So that's what he said. Then, The Spectator, which is a pro-Tory magazine, it had its front page today, had a cartoon, a very unflattering cartoon of Theresa May on her own. And it said something like, I think it was, lead or go. Well, I think we know she can't leave. She can't leave.
Yes.
So she should go. And if Nick Timothy is right, and if she goes, that means the end of Brexit.
Yes.
Yippee!
Yay!
So again, there are reasons to be optimistic, but not reasons to be complacent. And we are the underdogs, and we must not for one moment think that we are going to win, and we must not for one minute think that we don't need to persuade people. And I don't know where you are in Bath for Europe on this, but certainly Britain for Europe. I was talking to Tom Profato, which you're affiliated to. He was saying that this year you had decided, or they have decided, or whatever the collective had decided, that it was the challenge and the mission was to persuade. We do need to rally our core support. That's really important. We need to win back people who are, well, the 20% in this room who put their hand up and said, another question. Those people who put their hands up and said, we can't do it, would you like us to do it if we can? Put your hand up if you'd like us to do it if we can. And those people who think we can't do it, put your hands up if you don't want us to do it, even if we can. Okay, so we need to win those 20% back. We definitely need to win those 20% back. There's something, so we need to do those. But we also, that's not enough, because that only gets us to 48%. And, well, the opinion polls are showing actually maybe that the YouGov tracker actually is showing 55-45 in our favour. And that's starting to look, not bad, but it's not good enough. In my view, we need to get the polls to about 60-40 before we get an avalanche of politicians in our favour. And then it's game over. Then we've won. Also, if we win 60-40, then we put this thing to bed and we can't, Nigel Farage can't stick his head back above the parapet and say, oh, we've got to have another bloody referendum. So I think that's the game. And to get to that 60-40, we don't just need to re-energise our base, we need to persuade. Now, we're not going to persuade Nigel Farage, and we're not even going to persuade your local hero, Jacob Rees-Mogg, but there are a lot of people in this country, a lot of people in Bath, a lot of people in the surroundings who actually are patriotic Brits who care for their country, who are not bigoted, who have just not understood what actually was promised to them. And what's happening is that new facts are emerging. things that nobody, I didn't know, honestly, I didn't know that we were going to have to pay £40 billion to get out of the EU. I actually, my prediction is that if Theresa May gets her way, because she's saying we're going to need a 2-year transition, it's not going to be enough, we're going to need at least a 5-year transition, and the cost is going to be more like £80 billion than £40 billion. But I actually, even though I considered myself to be somewhat of an expert in this, I had no clue about this. So we do need to persuade. And I just want to say a couple of things about things to say and things not to say, and then I'm going to stop. I think the first thing is we should not tell people you were lied to, because that starts to come across as, I'm clever, I knew that they were lying to me, but you're not. And that is looking back. What we need is a message which is looking forward. Now, there is a variation on the theme, which is looking forward. And that is, as new facts emerge, it is becoming clear that staying in the EU is better than Brexit. And then you can come up with all the new facts, like, well, nurses are leaving the NHS. That's not good for the NHS. We're having to pay all this money to leave the EU. There's no sign of 350 million. The public finance has been destroyed, blah, 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 blah. So that's the way to sort of, you can cut the facts. There are lots and lots of facts. Every day there are new facts. But phrase it as something which is new facts emerging. People are quite happy psychologically to change their mind on the basis of new facts emerging, not on the basis that they got it wrong the first time round. The second thing is, don't say we need a second referendum. Say the people should have the final say if they want it. And I am a person, and I want it. Now, this may sound a bit silly, but first of all, opinion polls, focus groups, they show that actually, if you ask, and I gave you that that ICM poll in The Guardian showed 58-42. That was something like, when the deal is done, it should come back to the British people, and I can't remember the exact words. Maybe it may be referendum, or maybe final say, or something like that. But Michael Ashcroft, the Tory pollster, around the same time, he asked the question in four different ways. He asked, do you want a second referendum? Basically, it was about 60-40, not quite. Didn't want a second referendum. But do you want final say when we know what the terms of the deal are? Yes, then it's almost 60-40 in our favour. Now, you may say, what does that mean? Well, I think one thing it means is psychologically, people don't want to go backwards. They don't want to just go back to the same old bloody referendum that tore the country apart. But new facts, such as there is a new deal, let's look at it. As some person said, when you're buying a house, you put down an offer and it's accepted, but it's always subject to the survey. So people said they looked at the glossy brochure, it looks like a nice house, blah, blah, blah. Then they had the surveyor in, and they found dry rot, they found damp, they found that it was, well, Claire is a structural engineer, it was structurally unsound, this bloody house. They have the right to change their mind. If they wish. If we wish. We wish, well actually, we probably aren't changing our mind. I don't know, maybe there are people. But is there anyone who voted leave in this room? Don't worry, you're in safe company. Yes, yes, yes. One, two. Is there anybody in this room who didn't vote? Is there? Okay, here's another question. How many of the people in this room were activists before June the 23rd of 2018? I would say about a quarter. So a lot of you, well, maybe you're not activists now, but let's think optimistically, you weren't activists half an hour ago, you're going to be from tomorrow morning. So, yeah, this is so think to the future. The facts have changed, and it's clear that Brexit is worse than staying in the EU. If people want the final say, they damn well should have it. Because if you say, and this is another, if you say, I want a second referendum, people will say, will of the people voted, you're being undemocratic. If you say, we've got this government, it's botching Brexit, Theresa May hasn't got a clue, it's a disaster. Anyway, when she comes up with a deal, if she does come up with a deal, we should have the final say. If the people want it. People say, well, you're undemocratic. No, I'm not. What's more democratic than giving people the final say if they want it? Now, this means if they want it, we have to persuade people to want it. And the good news is that actually there has, although on the big question of do you want to stay in the EU or not, there's only been a smallish change in our favour. On that subsidiary question of do you want to have the final say, there seems to have been quite a big change in our favour. So, my message to you is indeed, yes, we can. But we won't unless we continue to fight for what we believe. But this matters so much. If we can actually turn this around, it will be a huge victory for our country. It will be a huge feather in the cap. And I'm delighted to see that so many of you are wearing caps of those who have put in the effort. So fight hard, fight fairly, fight to win. Yes, we can. Thank you.